الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد Regarding the Khilafah of Amir al-Mu'mineen Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, we spoke about some of the military victories during his time against the Romans. The first attack on what is currently Istanbul, which was called Constantinople at the time, which was the center of the Roman Empire, the power of the Roman Empire laid there under the leadership of his son Yazid ibn Muawiyah. And we talked about the great victories he had in Afghanistan, in current-day Pakistan, in current-day Uzbekistan, and on the Eastern Front as well. Now, we talk about the death of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and how Yazid became the leader of the Ummah after him. But before that, throughout these durus, as I have been preparing, reading the works of the Rafida Shia, as well as the works of many kuffar orientalists, as well as the authentic books of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, looking at the weak ahadith and sahih ahadith and looking at rijal and all of that, many objections have been put forth against Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And the way of the people of ta'assub is to always go to one side. Yani people, they come up with a idea first and foremost, and then they work to defend that idea. And this is not the way of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is not the way of the mu'min. This is not the way of the Muslim. The way of the Muslim, kama amara subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna Allah ya'maru bil adl wal ihsan. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran? That verily Allah has ordered upon you to be just, to be fair, and do things in the best manner with ihsan. So the way of this Thus, the manhaj here is to have adl. Yani we're not going to exaggerate on one side or the other side. It has to be what is in the authentic narrations. So I'll mention some of those objections, and I will talk about what is in the authentic narrations regarding them. The first, we find in many of the Shia books, and also in the books, some of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah as well. Why? Because the ulema of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, it's very important to understand. They were focused on tafsir of Quran, understanding of aqidah, on fiqh, on hadith, on ilm al-rijal, and all these sciences. When the Khawarij, the Mu'tazila, the Shia, mostly they focused on history. So they were able to fabricate many things. And some of the earlier ulema, their methodology, like Imam al-Tabari, in his tafsir and in his tariq, was to just collect everything. Because it's very early, it's around 300 Hijri. So the methodology was that these narrations would be lost. So the idea was to collect everything with asanid, with the chains, including narrations from the Rafida, from the Mu'tazila, from the Khawarij. And they would put the chain and they would put the names of those people there. So ulema would come later and be able to check the chains and be able to know what's authentic from weak. The unfortunate side of that is many people who were not ulema, or ulema that were not people of tahqiq, that didn't look at the asanid, didn't look at the rijal, didn't look at who was what, would find these narrations in these famous books and then depend on them without knowing their authenticity. So many of these accusations are also found in kutub like the Tariq of al-Tabari and the Tabaqat of Ibn Sa'ad and other books like this. Later ulema like Imam al-Zahabi and Ibn Kathir and other Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhum, they came and they refuted a lot of these, but they are still around, so we want to clarify them. Imam al-Tabari, just on a side note, his methodology was to collect everything, including mawdu' ahadith and matruk ahadith and ahadith with Rawafida and Mu'tazila and others in the Asanid, but he would just collect it, and then he would say later on, ulema can then further that work. Many of the ulema at that time, like the Hanabila, they took a disagreement to that. until it got to a point that it became very tense between them. And the Hanabila went once to the masjid and argued with him not to do this, until they threw ink pots at him. And when he ran, they threw him at his door until they blackened his door. And the idea was that the ink that is a sacred ink to be used for ilm, you're not using it correctly because you're including many fabrications into your works. His ijtihad was, like, my job is to put it together so it's not lost. You come later and then yani sift through the sahih and the da'if. So one of the accusations we find is that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu supposedly poisoned Hassan ibn Ali. This is an accusation you find in many books. And many Orientalists and others, they have written that, even though they follow it up by saying that there is no evidence for it. When we look in the kutub of hadith, no doubt, when we check the asanid, there is absolutely no evidence for this. The only evidence we find for this are people's accusations. Somebody without sanad that was not there would say that, oh, he poisoned him. It doesn't make sense from many perspectives. First, Hassan and Ibn Ali and Muawiyah radiallahu anhuma, they had already made peace treaty. So there was no threat to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. Secondly, if we look in the Sahih Ahadith, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and Hassan ibn Ali had a very good relationship. And from the first time they met after the death of Ali radiallahu anhu, they made sulh. And they had no problems. They never had a battle. They never had a fight. And after the sulh, we find many ahadith of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu sending gifts, and going and visiting Hassan ibn Ali, and Hassan ibn Ali going to Sham and visiting Muawiyah and taking gifts for him. So they had a very good relationship. Secondly, we find no evidence, yani nothing in the kutub of tariq bi sanad sahihan, with any evidence of it. Thirdly, Hassan ibn Ali himself mentioned that somebody from his household, from his wives, poisoned him. And we mentioned that because he wasn't poisoned once. Poison was put in his food repeatedly. And many times Allah blessed him, he got better, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote for him to leave this dunya as a shaheed, having been poisoned. If Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu was poisoning, how could he continuously be able to poison? He's in Sham. And how is he sending people and they're sneaking into his house and getting into his food? No way. And it's not possible. Rather, what we know from authentic hadith and the narration from Hassan ibn Ali radiallahu anhuma himself, that one of his wives who had given, he had given talaq to, who had a khariji mindset from the khawarij, she is the one that poisoned him. So this accusation is no doubt baseless. Yani it has no basis at all. So even if some of the books of tariq have mentioned this accusation, it is baseless. Second, there is an accusation that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he poisoned and killed Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn al-Walid. Abdurrahman, the son of Khalid ibn al-Walid. Khalid ibn al-Walid, the famous warrior of Islam. Abdurrahman was his son and one of the top generals of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And we talked about earlier how he was put in the forefront by Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, and he was the means of many victories during the time of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, a great warrior and a great fighter. He was poisoned, no doubt, but it was not by Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. There is, first off, again, no historic evidence. Even one of the Orientalists, his name is Henry Lemmens, L-A-M-M-E-N-S. I was reading his works, and he is a kafir, yani he's somebody who has a dislike for Islam. But even after mentioning these, he has to admit, he goes, but there is absolutely no historic evidence for these accusations. Tayyib, first and foremost, why would you poison your best general? Yani the one who's a means of victory. And Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn al-Walid was not running to become Khalifa. It's not like we have today, we have elections, you know, like you're worried about whether some Democrat or Republican or this or Green Party or that is going to take votes from you. It wasn't like they were running elections. So there was no threat to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu from Abdurrahman. Abdurrahman ibn al-Khalid was a general, he was a soldier. And that's what he stuck to. He never tried to come into the politics or come into the running for kingdom or leadership. So there was no threat to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. Fourthly, that if we look at the evidence in the Kutub al-Tariq, no doubt the one who poisoned him was one of the Ahlul Dhimma, one of the Christians. He was a physician, a doctor, and his name was Ibn Uthal. Some of the books have mentioned him, Athal bil Fatha al al-Hamza, فوق الألف, لكن يعني ما هو صحيح, Uthal. Ibn Uthal was the one that killed Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn Walid. He was one of the Ahlul Dhimma living, and he was somebody who had a hatred for the Muslims because he saw the victories of the Muslims against the Romans. He had a loyalty to the Romans who were Christians as well. And he was unable to poison Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, even though he was one of his physicians. But because Muawiyah radiallahu anhu had guards and he had a lot of yani, people around him, and that's one of the things about Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he was very careful about what he ate and who gave him what. He knew that there were people trying to assassinate him all the time. So he wasn't able to kill Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, so he decided to kill one of the greatest generals of the Muslim army at that time, which was Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn al-Walid. How do we know that definitely it was him that killed him? Because in Tariq, the accusation of him being the murderer was documented. There was an investigation headed by the police of that time under Muawiyah radiallahu anhu into Ibn Athal. Now, when we look at Tariq in the Sahih Hadith, and this is an authentic narration, once the son of Abdurrahman, his name is Khalid ibn Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn al-Walid. So Khalid ibn al-Walid, the famous Sahabi, Sayfullah, he has a son named Abdurrahman. He is the one that was poisoned here. His son is also named Khalid. And this is the way of the Arab. They would name their children after their grandfathers. So Abdurrahman يعني, named his son after his son's grandfather, his own father, which was Khalid. So the son's name is Khalid, the son of Abdurrahman, the son of Khalid ibn al-Walid. He went to Mecca, yarhamakallah. When he went to Mecca, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah, the son of Zubayr ibn Awam, he met him and they were friends. Yani they had acquaintance, they knew each other well, and both great warriors. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, in a way to bring out the ghira in him, he told him, Aina ibn Athal? And where is ibn Athal? He killed your father and you're here in Mecca. How come you aren't taking revenge? And Khalid ibn Abdurrahman, ibn Khalid ibn Walid, his ghira was raised. He went to Sham. He found ibn Athal riding. He attacked him. He hit him on the neck, severed his head, and killed him as a revenge for his father. Now, even though the investigation was still going on, so the Shari'i court had not given that hukam yet, but when Khalid ibn Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn al-Walid killed the murderer of his father, Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu allowed him to go free because he said that our suspicion was that he is the one that killed your father. So because of that, you will not be brought into account for killing the murderer of your father. So this tells us that no doubt his son knew who killed his father. The Ummah at that time, even if they didn't have the witnesses, they knew who the murderer was. It was such a well-known fact that even Abdullah ibn Zubayr in Mecca knew about the one who killed him. If it was Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, then Khalid ibn Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn Walid should have gone and killed Muawiyah. And the fact that the Sahaba and Tabi'un and the Qudha, they accepted the fact that Ibn Athil was killed for the murder of Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn Walid, that means that no doubt this accusation against Muawiyah radiallahu anhu is again false. In fact, Ibn Uthal was the one that murdered Abdurrahman ibn Khalid ibn Walid, who was a great general and a very close friend of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. Third accusation. This is something strange. And I find this in a lot of the books of the Ahl Sunnah as well, even though it is absolutely baseless, which is that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu wanted to move the member of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Medina to Sham. And unfortunately, even some of the English works that have been printed and many of our brothers are passing it around and things have mentioned such a strange accusation. Looking into the Kutub of Hadith and Kutub of Tariq, there is no sanad, absolutely, that mentions this. In fact, this story was made up hundreds of years later, where they mention that he was trying to take the member of Rasulullah sallam to Sham, which why would you even do that? I mean, what was the benefit of that? And then eclipse happened, and another narration, clouds came, and then he left it. And again, eclipse don't happen because of these kinds of things as clarified by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the death of his own son. This is the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khair, this is a mawdu', a fabrication. In fact, there is no sanad at all that can be depended upon for such a narration. Rather, what we find in the Sahih Ahadith is that Muawiyah radiyallahu, when he came to Medina, he saw the member of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The member of Rasulullah sallam had three steps, as our member here does as well, three steps. And this is the sunnah. And this is the correct way to have three steps in the member. But Muawiyah radiyallahu, he saw that Masjid al-Nabwi had grown. And the people in Masjid al-Nabwi had grown. So they were sitting even all the way outside at what was at that time the gates of Masjid al-Nabwi. And he realized they couldn't see the khatib. So he added three more steps to the member of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, making it six, to raise the khatib higher so the people can see him. Now, this is his ijtihad. His ijtihad was that the number of steps is not important. What's important is the khatib should be seen. Some of the imam and ulema said the best is to leave it at three, and that's what we have find in most of our masajid, and that's fine. But this is not an issue of bid'ah or an issue of something haram. This is the issue of him trying to make things easy for the ummah. And if he's adding steps to the member and he's increasing it and protecting it, how can he be the one taking it to Sham? This is again a baseless argument. What we find in Sahih Ahadith is rather that he preserved and increased to the member of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Medina. Tayyib, the next accusation, and this is very well spread out towards the ummah today, especially because of the Rafid of the Shia, is that Muawiyah radiyan killed Hujr ibn Adi. Hujr ibn Adi radiyallahu anhu was no doubt a Sahabi and a very pious Sahabi. He was somebody who was very much inclined towards supporting Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. And he fought against Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu and so on. When Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu became the Khalifa, he forgave everybody that fought against him. He took them as brothers. And Ziyad, who was also one of the generals of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu, and also fought against Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, when Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu became Khalifa, he made Ziyad an Amir. He made him a governor. And he put him in charge of the armies that were fighting in battles, as we talked about earlier. Ziyad, being in Kufa as the Amir there, he also spoke to Hujr ibn Adi to now make islah between the ummah. Hujr ibn Adi had his own ijtihad. He's a Sahabi and we respect him as a Sahabi radiyallahu anhu. But his ijtihad was that Ali radiyallahu anhu was a haq, and after Ali radiyallahu anhu, those from his generation like Hassan and Hussein radiyallahu anhuma had more haq. This was his ijtihad. And because of that, he would not accept the umara put by Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu. And he had his own followers with him who would give a hard time. Ziyad, he was also one of the generals of Ali radiyallahu anhu and was now the Amir. He got sick of this. So he invited Hujr ibn Adi to a meeting, and Hujr ibn Adi said, "I want aman, I want that you will not harm me." He said, "You have aman." He sat down with him, gave him nasiha. Hujr ibn Adi and him were not seeing eye to eye. So Ziyad said that what you are doing is fitna. And fitna is ashaddu min al-qatl, it is worse than murder. And what you are doing, you may not realize, but will start the battles between the Muslims again, and we're trying to keep the peace, so I'm going to send you as exiled. Hujr ibn Adi said, "Send me to Muawiyah, and whatever hukam Muawiyah gives, I will accept." Ziyad agreed. He got the people to sign a paper documenting the rebellion of Hujr ibn Adi and what he had done to cause problems at that time. This was sent to Muawiyah. Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, he received the case. And he received tazkiyah from many of the Sahaba speaking about the piety and the goodness of Hujr ibn Adi. Hujr ibn Adi radiyallahu anhu was a Sahabi, he was a pious man. He made his ijtihad, he made a mistake. Whether he was right or wrong is a different issue. But to cause a problem within a united Muslim Khilafah is not permissible. And the hukam for the one who causes rebellion is death, yani, in the Khilafah. As you would find even in America and other places for treason where you try to cause a rebellion, yani, the hukam is death. So the generals of Muawiyah, they took this and they understood him to be a rebel and they went to go kill him. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, thinking over this and realizing that he's a Sahabi, wrote a letter, and the books of hadith have this letter documented where he wrote and he said, do not harm Hujr ibn Adi. Why? Because he is from the Ashab al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But his generals, before they got the letter, they had already killed him. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was not in the favor, nor did he order this killing. He had not given that hukam. In fact, in the Sahih hadith, when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu went for Umrah, Aisha radiallahu anha called her. She called him and she told him that what you did with Hujr ibn Adi was wrong. And he explained this in the Sahih hadith. He said, I did not give the hukam for the death of Hujr ibn Ali, rather his own people killed him. And what he means by that is the people of Kufa that wrote against him. And when the generals brought him and they found that his own people and the umara, the leaders like Ziyad and others, had signed that he is causing a rebellion and a fitna within the ummah, because of this, the people, they put him to death. She told Aisha Raniha that I personally wrote a letter to save his life, but it did not reach them in time. So once again, Muawiyah radiyan is free from this accusation. He is not the one that ordered the death of Hujr ibn Adi. May Allah accept Hujr ibn Adi as a shaheed. Yani, he made ijtihad. Even if he was wrong in it, we ask Allah to accept him as a sahabi, as a shaheed. And we ask Allah to forgive those that put him to death, not understanding the situation, thinking that he was a rebel in the ummah. And either way, this is an issue of ijtihad. Muawiyah radiyan being free from both of those. Tayyib. The next accusation, and this is the biggest accusation against Muawiyah radiyan hu, and this is going to be the bulk of our discussion today, is that Muawiyah appointed his son Yazid as the Khalifa after him. Tayyib. In the Islamic Khilafah, upon the manhaj of Nabuwa, yani in the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has taught us, we don't have the concept of kingship in the sense that your son or your brother becomes king after you. This is not an Islamic concept. This idea that one family should rule is not an Islamic concept. The Islamic Khilafah is done in such a way that the most pious, the most able, the most capable is the one who leads, no matter what family he's from, no matter what background he's from. And that's why you saw amongst the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, you had Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had children, very pious children, but they did not become Khulafa after him. Rather, Umar ibn Khattab, who is from a different branch of Quraysh, and even though he's Qurayshi, but he's from a different clan. But he is the one that became Khalifa after him, because Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu saw him to be the most capable. After Umar radiallahu anhu, he didn't have somebody from his tribe or his son Abdullah ibn Umar, who was a great Sahabi, who was great, yani very capable, very intelligent, one of the most knowledgeable of the Sahaba, one of the greatest narrators of hadith, the strictest of the Sahaba on the Sunnah that we know from many ahadith and his virtues. But he didn't assign him or any of his other sons or anybody from his clan to be Khalifa after him. Uthman ibn Affan, who was from again a different clan within the Quraysh, he was the one that was made Khalifa after them. And Uthman radiyanhu also did not choose somebody from Banu Umayyah or from yani his clan to be Khalifa after him, nor did he put his sons or anybody else rather than that. Then came the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyanhu, and then Muawiyah radiyanhu, all from different yani varying tribes. So now the accusation gets to be that why did Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu assign his son Yazid to be Khalifa after him? Tayyib. The first thing is, I found in the books of the enemies of Islam, the Shia, that they blame the whole thing on a Sahabi named Mughira ibn Shu'bah. Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah is a great Sahabi, a very pious Sahabi, a great Mujahid fi sabilillah, a great narrator of hadith. If you pick up books of hadith, you will definitely find narrations from him, like the narration about Mas'ha on the Imamah, and Mas'ha on Khufayn, and many of the hadith about Tahara, they will be narrated from Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu. The interesting thing is that the bay'ah that was taken or began to be taken for Yazid was around 55 Hijri, and taking the bay'ah actually 56 Hijri. Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah died in 50 Hijri. Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah died 6 years before the bay'ah was even begun to be taken for Yazid. So this tells you the kind of imagination these people have, and these kinds of fake stories that they make. That they take somebody and they put him in a situation that would happen 6 years after his own death. Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah was a great Sahabi. He was one of the governors of Muawiyah. He had a good relationship with Yazid, but he is not the one that went around and collected the bay'ah. In fact, he died 6 years before that. So this is a false accusation against the great Sahabi, Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah. Tayyib. Now, the objection still stands that when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was looking to make his son Yazid ibn Muawiyah, the leader of the Muslim Ummah, the Khalifa, to get the bay'ah, at that time, Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn Khattab, Hussein ibn Ali, Abdullah ibn Zubayr were alive. And they were great Sahaba, and they were great ulama, and they were people of great piety. And no doubt, in accordance to the usul of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Abdullah ibn Umar, or Hussein ibn Ali, or Abdullah ibn Zubayr were greater in status than Yazid. Because Yazid was not a Sahabi. Yazid ibn Muawiyah was not a Sahabi. He was born during the Khilafah of Uthman ibn Affan. Even though he has his own virtues, he's a Tabi'i, he has his own virtues, and we'll discuss that. But no doubt, as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we have to have adal and say that Abdullah ibn Umar and Hussein ibn Ali and Abdullah ibn Zubayr were of greater status, because first and foremost they were from the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they are the best of this ummah after the Anbiya. And no doubt that they were greater in knowledge. Yani Abdullah ibn Umar especially, we know him to be a great alim of the sunnah, and yani they were more famous for their taqwa and their piety. But this is the issue of ijtihad. Tayyib, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, and I'm not going to guess at why he did what he did. This is one of the problems I see in a lot of the lectures and books, is they guess. Rather, I'm going to go back to the kutub of tariq and read to you what he wrote himself and said. Yani other people wrote it, but what he said about why he made the decision he made. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, in the Sahih Hadith, he sat with Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn Khattab. He told him that I am afraid that the people of Iraq will betray Hussein ibn Ali as they betrayed his father, and the war will start again. So you look at the first aspect of his ijtihad. If you look at the people of Iraq, they betrayed Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. And even though Ali ibn Talib radiyallahu anhu was a great warrior and very intelligent, but we saw that Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu came out on top, because the people of Sham were united and loyal, and the people of Iraq, they used to betray their word to Ali radiyallahu anhu. And this is from the farasa of Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, but as we will study during these durus, the people of Iraq will betray Hussein ibn Ali. This is something interesting, because this hadith happened before the fitna of Karbala, before any of that happened, but Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu had the farasa, the foresight, to see that this would happen, and it ended up happening. Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu continued speaking to Abdullah ibn Umar. He said, the people of Sham will not accept Hussein ibn Ali. He said, because Hussein ibn Ali has not been involved in the leadership of this ummah. Yani if you look at qualifications, no doubt Hussein ibn Ali is pious. There is no doubt to his piety. He is from the people of Jannah. There is no doubt to that. He is the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is, and not just that, just being related to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not enough in itself. There are relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Nar, right? Like Abu Lahab. Nobody can deny that one, right? But Hussein ibn Ali was pious. Hussein ibn Ali was a zahid. Hussein ibn Ali was a alim. So no doubt to all of that. But Hussein ibn Ali was not somebody with experience in leadership of the ummah at the time. Yani, this is another thing you have to think about. Sometimes a person may be more pious, but they may not be the best leaders. I'll give you an example. Some of the Sahaba, like Bara ibn Malik, the brother of Anas ibn Malik, he was very pious, very brave. But Abu Bakr radiyan and would write a letter with him that do not make him the Amir of anything. Because he is a very pious man, but he only wants to become Shaheed. He will only get everybody killed as Shuhada, but he will not win the victories. Because he didn't have that leadership quality of thinking about how to be successful in campaigns. He only cared about Zuhud and going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like, I'll give you an example. It's a different example, but I hope it will open up your minds. Sometimes you will have a zahid who will not be an alim. Tayyib? Like you will see somebody very pious, up at night making a lot of qiyam al-layl and making a lot of dhikr and crying a lot in their dua and crying in their salah and always being very clear in the halal and haram. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah, Allahumma barik lahum. Excellent. But if they're not ulama, don't go to them for fatwa. Even if their zuhud is amazing, go to the alim. Because even if the alim may not be at the same level as a zahid, but he has experience with ilm. Because what happens when you go to a zahid for a fatwa is what happened with the man in the sahih hadith that had killed 99 people. He killed 99 people. He went to somebody of zuhud and he told him, can I ever be forgiven? Now the person who's a zahid, he's not thinking through ilm. He's thinking through his fear of Allah. He thinks murder is such a big sin and you did it 99 times, no way can you be forgiven. Because to him, sins are such a horrible thing. The man killed him, made it 100. Then he went to a person of ilm, person of knowledge. And the person of knowledge, he gave him an answer in the light of knowledge. He told him, yes, you can be forgiven, but you have to leave your environment. You have to go make hijrah, be with the pious, make tawbah, leave. So what does that tell you? Sometimes a person may be a great zahid, but he may not be a great leader. He may be a great zahid, but he may not be an alim. He may be a great zahid, but he may not be good at organizing. So in this, Muawiyah radiyallahu, looking at the fadail of Hussein ibn Ali, but also looking at his experience, or the lack thereof in leadership, looking at the situation in the ummah and not wanting that a civil war break out again, that if Hussein ibn Ali was made the Khalifa and the people of Sham and Banu Umayyah and others rebelled and a war began again, and knowing that the people of Iraq would betray Hussein ibn Ali, he made the decision, as he mentions here, or in here when he's speaking to Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, I have an intention to put my son Yazid, because he is somebody who is very capable. And I will explain about his abilities, inshallah ta'ala. But this was the ijtihad of Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu. Tayyib. Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu is a Sahabi. We respect the Sahaba, we do not criticize the Sahaba. Maybe his ijtihad was wrong. But if it was, he'll still get a reward. Because he did his best to make ijtihad. Tayyib. Regarding Yazid and his qualifications, no doubt he was loved by the people of Sham and the people that fought under him. And the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari mentioned that the Sahaba said, we were in the land of the Romans and Yazid was our Amir. Yani he was assigned as an Amir over armies during the Khilafah of Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, and the armies serving under him loved him. And the people of Sham that were under his authority loved him. So he was somebody who was loved by his people. He had proven his military skill. No doubt as a general, he had had great successes. And we spoke about that in the last dars, about his victories against the Romans and others. And no doubt he was an intelligent person. And if you look at the hadith about him, he was a person of intelligence. The people of Sham and Iraq and Misr and others in 56 Hijri When Muawiyah radiyallahu asked them to give bay'ah to Yazid, they agreed. Yani almost the entire ummah, except for a few people, and we'll talk about that inshallah, agreed. The ulama of Islam said that there were more than 1,000 sahaba alive at that time. At least 60 of them, whose names have been documented in the books of hadith, gave bay'ah to him. So what does that mean? That the people saw him qualified. The people of Iraq even. The people of Sham. The people of Misr. The people of Hijaz. And we'll talk about some of the ones that didn't. But in majority of the ummah, and the vast majority of the sahaba, including 60 that we can actually name through a hadith, gave bay'ah to him to show that he was somebody very capable. From them, who was a great supporter of him, and somebody who gave bay'ah to him and defended him, is Muhammad al-Hanafiyya. Tayyib, Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, who is he? He is the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. He's not born from Fatima radiyallahu anha. He's born from a woman called al-Hanafiyya. And that's why many of the kutub mention Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, but he is Muhammad ibn Ali. And he is the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu, just as much as Hassan Hussein radiyallahu anhuma were the sons of Ali radiyallahu anhu. Just because he's not born from Fatima does not mean he's not the son of Ali radiyallahu anhu. He's from Ahlul Bayt. His lineage goes through Ali radiyallahu anhu. So now Muhammad al-Hanafiyya was one of the people that defended Yazid and gave him bay'ah. When we talk about the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, one of the greatest of Sahaba alive at that time was Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhum. He was one of the people that Muawiyah approached regarding the bay'ah for Yazid. Abdullah ibn Umar told him that I have no problem giving bay'ah to Muawiyah, but I will not give it until the time when he is ready to be Khalifa. Meaning, while you are alive, he told Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, I'm not going to give bay'ah to your son. Because if you die and the ummah splits, I don't want to be a part of a split. If you die and the ummah agrees on Yazid, then my bay'ah is with him. Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu did not force Abdullah ibn Umar. He told him, fine. And as we will see in tariq, that's what happened. When the ummah united behind Yazid, Abdullah ibn Umar also gave bay'ah. But we look at the hilm of Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu. Muawiyah could have forced him. He could have put the sword to him. He's just one man. But he told him, no, we'll not force the bay'ah from anybody. Next, we look at some of the people who did not give bay'ah. And in fact, there are only three. Out of the whole ummah, there were three people. One of them was Hussein ibn Ali radiyallahu anhuma, the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The other was Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr radiyallahu anhuma, the son of Abu Bakr. And the third was Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiyallahu anhuma, the son of Zubayr ibn Awam. Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, he approached them regarding Yazid. And when Marwan, who was one of the umara of Muawiyah, and we'll speak about Marwan in detail later on, inshaAllah. When he approached them, he told them that this is the sunnah of Abu Bakr and Umar. Yani, Abu Bakr radiyallahu assigned Umar radiyallahu to be Khalifa before he even died. At the last moments of his life, but before he died. And Umar radiyallahu, he made a shura to choose the next Khalifa before he died. So Marwan told them that in that way, Muawiyah does not want. Now, Muawiyah radiyallahu himself is not speaking to them. This is Marwan speaking to them in Al-Madinah. He tells them that Muawiyah does not want that death comes upon him and the ummah falls back into fitan. Because the last thing anybody wanted was civil war again. Alhamdulillah, the Muslims were united at this time. They were fighting the kuffar. They were having victories. So Muawiyah radiyallahu wanted to plan ahead to make sure the ummah stays united. Hussein ibn Ali radiyallahu anhuma told him, I need a night to think. I need to think it over. Marwan told him, go ahead. During that night, Hussein ibn Ali, he left Medina and he went to Mecca. He didn't give his response. Now at that time, the people told Marwan that Hussein ibn Ali is leaving. You should grab him and bring him back to make sure that he gives you his answer. He told him no. He told him, he is from Ahlul Bayt. He is the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We will make ikram for him. If he wants to go, let him go. And he was sent. Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr, he was very harsh against Marwan. He told Marwan, this is not the sunnah of Abu Bakr and Umar. This is the sunnah of Qaisar and Kisra. And a very harsh response. And he told him, in Islam, we don't have this where your son becomes Khalifa after you. Marwan told him, look, it is not just because he is his son. He finds him to be the most qualified. So what's wrong with his decision? This is the ijtihad of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And the Ummah is agreeing on this. You should give bayah. Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr did not give bayah. Tell you, but Marwan didn't force him. And Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu is still alive. At this time, the discussion got heated. Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr walked out and walked to the house of Aisha radiyallahu anha. Marwan and his people, they followed him, but they didn't dare enter the house out of respect for Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, for Aisha radiyallahu anha, and they let Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr be. They didn't force him to give bayah as well. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he said that I will give you my response, but he also fled to Mecca. Now why flee to Mecca? Because the Amir of Mecca was not in very well control of Mecca. So they were able to go to Mecca and not be under authority. I mean, they just went and they were by themselves. As time continued, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr, he died. Yani in 55 Hijri, he died. Now the actual bayah was not taken till 56 Hijri. So this was an initial conversation that was being had on the authority of Muawiyah. In 56 Hijri, there were only two people left now. Only two people left that were not agreed upon Yazid to be the leader, and that was Abdullah ibn Zubayr and Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhum. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu himself went from Sham to go visit them in Mecca. And he called them and he told them that, to Abdullah ibn Zubayr for example, that I want you to give bay'ah, not right now, but that if I die, your bay'ah will be with my son Yazid, so that the ummah does not fall into fitna. Abdullah ibn Zubayr told Muawiyah in the Sahih Hadith that if you are sick of ruling, like if you're tired of ruling, then step down, you give him bay'ah, and I'll give him bay'ah. And he gave him a harsh response back. Right? And he told him, if you're going to continue to rule, then why should I give you my bay'ah now? I'll wait till you die, and then we'll see what happens with your son. Very harsh response. But Muawiyah radiyallahu, he had hilm. And this is a good lesson for our leaders, to have that softness. He didn't tell him, I'm Amir al-Mu'mineen, what's wrong with you? And you're speaking like this. No, he told him, okay. He left him alone. Now, Husayn ibn Ali, he avoided meeting with Muawiyah at that time when he had come, and he continued to have his mindset. When Muawiyah radiyallahu sat down with some of the Sahaba in Mecca, there's a beautiful hadith where he said that in the time of Umar, Umar radiyallahu saw six Sahaba with the ability to be Khulafa. Very interesting. He told him, Umar, out of all of the Sahaba, he saw six. From them, Uthman ibn Affan, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Zubayr ibn Awam, and Saad ibn Abi Waqqas, radiallahu anhu. He told them, from you six, choose a leader. That means Umar radiallahu saw these six to be capable to be khulafa, any one of them. He said, all of them have left this dunya. And at that time, Uthman ibn Affan had already been made shaheed, Ali radiallahu had been shaheed, Abdurrahman ibn Auf had already passed away, Talha and Zubayr radiyallahu had become shuhada, and Sa'd ibn Waqqas radiyallahu died in 55 Hijri. So in 56 Hijri he had also died. So Muawiyah radiyallahu said that if none of those are alive today, that means I don't have a precedence on somebody being yani automatically in the running for Khalifa. He said, I made an oath that if Hassan ibn Ali was alive at the time of my death, he would be Khalifa after me, but he has also become a Shaheed. So from those in front of me, I find Yazid to be the most qualified. This was his ijtihad. Now, When we look at Muawiyah radiyallahu and his ijtihad, he took this message to Hassan ibn Ali. Hassan ibn Ali did not accept that, but he did not rebel against him either. Yani, like Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he didn't give bayah, but he didn't rebel. So those two were left. Other than these two people, the entire ummah came to an agreement. Entire ummah, nobody disagreed. Now, when we talk about Muawiyah radiyallahu, he died in Rajab, in the holy month of Rajab, in 60 Hijri. And this is in 56 Hijri. In 60 Hijri he died. And at the time of his death, as we had mentioned before, he knew his death was coming. He was told by his doctors that you're going to die. So he dressed up in his finest clothing, and he opened up the doors, and he told the people that to let the people come and visit me. I don't want to be from those khulafa that don't give the people their rights. Let them come visit me, and let them see that I'm not afraid of death, that I'm not somebody who's afraid of death. If the coward, as Muawiyah radiyallahu mentions, if the coward can talk during his life, at his death, you will know his reality. And everybody can talk, brave, but when death comes to you, then you realize who's who. Everybody, like, you know, when we used to go to school, everybody could talk. But when somebody gets a gun put to their face, then you'll see their reality come out. Right? And that's the thing. Muawiyah radiyallahu was somebody that was brave in dunya, brave in his life, and he was brave at the time of his death. He wasn't afraid of death. He greeted it. And he wrote beautiful poetry. And those people that went to ghulu on the side of Ali radiyallahu and cursed Muawiyah radiyallahu, he spoke against them in that poetry. He said, they speak all this stuff, but I will see them at their times of death, how they will act. And let them come see me at the time of death. I welcome death and I want to go be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he left this dunya at 60 Hijri. At his death, the entire ummah, the people of Sham, the people of Iraq, the people of Hijaz, the people of Misr, all of them, yani they gave bayah to his son because that was already set in place, except for two people. Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr had already died, so he was out of it. The only other two people were Hussein ibn Ali and Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Abdullah ibn Umar, he also gave bayah, but we'll talk about that a little bit in the next dars, inshallah, how exactly that happened, but he gave bayah as well. Tayyib, when we talk about Yazid becoming the leader, I want to introduce Yazid a little bit in this dars, and then we'll continue in the next dars about his yani khilafah, his leadership. I read in one of the books of the Shia, they wrote about him that he was a kafir worse than Fir'aun. And you look at the ta'assub that the people have. Fir'aun, somebody cursed in the Quran. Fir'aun, somebody who died on kufr. Fir'aun, somebody who fought against the Nabi of Allah. And they went to this ta'assub. But as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we're going to use evidence to guide our decisions. Yazid was not a Sahabi, even though there are those who went to an extreme and tried to claim he was a Sahabi. But no doubt, if you look in the Kutub of Tariq, what is authentic that he was not a Sahabi, even though there are many Sahaba named Yazid. And I want to clarify that, because today in our ummah, today if you name your son Yazid, it is as if, na'udhu billah, you named him Fir'aun. Yani imagine in some of the countries, other than in Sham, mashallah, you hear the name Yazid. But if you go to Afghanistan or Pakistan or these countries, and you say, my son is named Yazid, I mean, the Ahl Sunnah will be the first one to chase you and beat you. Yani something ajeeb. For these durus, I went and looked up the book Al-Isaba fi Tam'eez al-Sahaba. I found Ibn Hajar Asqalani had documented 170 of the Sahaba named Yazid. 170 of the Ashab of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, whose biographies we know. Right? Al-Isaba has about 10,000 biographies. We know there were over 100,000 Sahaba, so who knows how many more there were, but 170 we can document they were named Yazid. So if somebody names their child Yazid, there's nothing wrong with this. Yazid, the brother of Muawiyah, for example, was a great Sahabi. Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan, a great Mujahid, a great Zahid, a Sahabi, and many other Sahaba named Yazid. The Yazid we're talking about is not a Sahabi, he is a Tabi'i. But he is the son of a Sahabi. His kunya was Abu Khalid. يعني he had a son named Khalid. His kunya was Abu Khalid. He is Yazid ibn Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. Now, when we speak about him, I will mention only the Sahih Hadith. In the Sahih Hadith that Ibn Kathir had mentioned Bidaya wa Nihaya, and Al-Dhahabi and others have as well, Ibn Abbas. I want to mention, who is the Rawi here? Ibn Abbas radiyanhuma, from Ahlul Bayt, from the son of Abbas, the one that the Rafida claimed to love. He narrates the Hadith Sahih. He went to Muawiyah. Muawiyah radiyan, who came and did ta'ziyah for the death of Hassan ibn Ali. Hassan ibn Ali, also from the family. يعني, so he told him, we know that Hassan ibn Ali died. And he told Yazid to go and do the ta'ziyah to him. Yazid went to Ibn Abbas radiyan huma, and he sat down. Ibn Abbas was sitting higher, he sat lower. And he expressed the ta'ziyah and he made dua for Hassan ibn Ali and for sabr for Ibn Abbas and his family. Ibn Abbas, seeing Yazid with good qualities, he told him, come and sit next to me. Yarhamakullah. Yazid told him, no. He told him, I'm here to do ta'ziyah to you. And for the one who is giving you condolences, the adab is he sits lower. And the one who comes to give you good news or greets you for something good sits next to you. And this is from adab, from etiquette. So when Ibn Abbas saw this, he said about Banu Harb, yani from Harb lineage, he said, when they die, adab will die. He said he saw such good manners from Yazid. Ibn Abbas praised Yazid such. In the Sahih Hadith. Second Hadith, also Sahih Hadith, as Ibn Kathir and others, Ibn Sa'ad and others have mentioned, Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, Muhammad ibn Ali, radiyallahu anhuma. From Ahlul Bayt. Both of these ahadith I'm mentioning from people of Ahlul Bayt. The son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyanhu, he went to visit Muawiyah. On that trip, he traveled with Yazid. Him and Yazid were traveling together. And when you travel with somebody, you get to know them. And sometimes you meet somebody, mashallah, they're good, but then you travel with them and then you see they turn the AC too high or something, and you have issues there. You know. So when you travel with somebody, you get to know their personality. So when Yazid and Muhammad al-Hanafiyya were traveling, Yazid turned to Muhammad al-Hanafiyya at the end of the travel, and he told him, if you saw something as a shortcoming in me, tell me so I can fix it. Yani, this is a very beautiful adab in and of itself. Today, nobody does this. Today, nobody wants to be criticized. Nobody wants to know about their weaknesses. Yani, today, you could travel with somebody and they'll tell you, so, how'd you like my driving? It's pretty good, right? They want that praise from you. But nobody will tell you, tell me my shortcomings. But this is the way of the Salaf. And no doubt, Yazid is from the Salaf. He's a tabi'i. Right? This is the way of the Salaf. To want to know their weaknesses to better themselves. So he told Muhammad al-Hanafiyya that if you saw shortcomings, please inform me. Muhammad al-Hanafiyya in the Sahih Hadith says, Wallahi, I didn't see any shortcomings from you. And if I had, I would have told you because Allah has forbidden us from not doing nahi ala al-munkar. Allah has ordained upon us that we see some munkar, we have to correct it. So if I saw something wrong you were doing, I would have told you already. This is from Muhammad ibn Ali, who is known as Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, Ahlul Bayt. Now, when we look at Yazid, he's not a Sahabi, so we will discuss him, yani his mistakes as well. And no doubt, he made some mistakes in Ijtihad. And we'll discuss them, inshallah, in the light of authentic evidences. But we also have to be fair and discuss his good. During the lifetime of Muawiyah radiyanhu, he was made the Amir for Hajj. Yani, multiple times, he was responsible for Hajj. And that takes a lot of ilm. Because the Amir of Hajj was not somebody as a figurehead as the nowadays, but rather somebody who would actually deal with all of the organization, that would actually give the khutbah, that would actually answer all the fiqh questions, all the khilaf that would come between the people. He would be the final authority. So it shows his administrative abilities and his knowledge. He was the Amir in Jihad repeatedly, as it's been reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and other books of Sahih al-Hadith. So no doubt he was an experienced military man and leader. We find in the Sahih Hadith that when he was very young, Muawiyah radiyallahu had Sahaba become يعني, people who taught him adab. And this is something the Arab had as a very beautiful characteristic. When they had a young son, they would find a person of ilm, of knowledge, and they would tell him, be the muadhib for my son. Teach my son adab, manners. So to that knowledgeable, experienced person would then teach that young man when to speak, when to be quiet, when to sit, when to stand, when to do this and when to do that, how to follow the sunnah, would teach him ilm, knowledge, and adab. And this was something beautiful that we found from Muawiyah radiyallahu for Yazid. When he became Khalifa, some of the Tabi'een, not Sahaba, they went to Muhammad al-Hanafiyyah and they told him that why would you support Yazid when you know that people have accused him of drinking alcohol and people have accused him of not praying and people have accused him of wasting time and indulging in useless activities and indulging in sins openly. Muhammad ibn Ali radiyallahu anhuma, the from Ahlul Bayt, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu, Muhammad al-Hanafiyyah, in the Sahih Hadith, he told the man, he said, did you see any of this yourself? SubhanAllah, beautiful answer. He says, did you see this? The man said, what does it matter when I know it's true? He told him, if you saw him drinking, that means you were drinking with him. And it's a beautiful answer, right? If you saw him drinking, that means you were drinking with him. If you saw him not pray, that means you weren't praying either. If you were praying, then how would you know he's not praying? If you saw him wasting time on playing and things, then you were in the games with him. And if you didn't see this, then you're doing kadhab on somebody. You're making a false accusation, buhtan. Today we see this in our ummah. In our ummah. Yani, I was somewhere once, and we were there trying to call people towards يعني, amal salihat and things in da'wah. And I saw somebody, myself, who used to sweep the streets in another country. And this job is probably the lowest paid job in the whole country. Right? They're looked down upon, they're the street sweepers. I told this man, and he come with us to the masjid and things. He said, you guys, you're paid by the British. And you are paid 40,000 or 40 lakh, I don't know what that, 400,000 rupees per year if you do this and you're paid. And he had this whole like chart laid out. So I told him, yani, if that's true, then you must have gotten paid too, because how do you know then how much I get paid, right? And if you don't get paid, then why don't you get a job with the British? You will be going to the masjid, you will be calling people to salah, you won't be sitting in filthy poop cleaning the streets, and you will get paid a lot better. So you see, today we have the same kind of stupid mentality. This guy, he went to the FBI and he was in the office and he was saying this. How do you know? Were you in the office with him? Were you part of the team? Right? These accusations in the ummah today, this sheikh, he gets paid by Saudiya this much and this much. How do you know? Are you the one that writes the check? Do you cash it for him? Yani, this is a very big disease in our ummah today, false accusation, buhtan. This guy, he does this, this guy, how do you know? Did you see him yourself? Do you have witnesses? No? Then stay quiet. Muhammad al-Hanafiyyah, he told him that if you saw this, then you would engage in it as well. And if you didn't see it, then you are doing kadhab, yani you are lying in buhtan. And then Muhammad al-Hanafiyyah said, I traveled with him and I stayed with him on multiple occasions. Not once, many times. And all I saw from him was strict performance of salah and salah in jama'ah. And in making salah in congregation. All I saw from him was always bahat al khair, yani looking for whatever has khair in it. And strict ittiba' sunnah. I saw him strict on the sunnah. And I saw him asking questions in fiqh. And he wanting to learn knowledge. Now, this man, he told him he only did this to show off to you. Muhammad al-Hanafiya told him that, how do you know his niyyah? Did you tear open his heart? How do you know his niyyah? Why would he want to show off to me when he is the leader, or at that time the son of the leader, when he is from the rulers and I am just a regular Muslim? What does he have to show off to me for? Why does he need to impress me? And he refuted him and showed him proof that every time he had seen him with his own eyes being strict on the sunnah and on salah and on piety. And he said, if you have not eyewitnesses, then I wish I was in charge, because I would have had you whipped for buhtan. Now, why did Abdullah ibn Zubayr and Hussein ibn Ali not give bay'ah? And how did Yazid deal with that? Inshallah, we'll discuss at the next dars. Jazakumullahu khairan.